Studying the complexities and continuities ingrained throughout the African world is no easy task, but is a project that must be meticulously and judiciously carried out in an effort to piece back the socio-political and cultural memory of a people who was purposefully fractured, scattered across the world, something that Ngugi wa Thiong'o calls remembering. What must not be lost is that the cultural life of African peoples has been the direct target of those who insistently seek to control, dominate, and or marginalize what it considers to be alien or foreign to their particular socio-political and cultural ways of being. As a result, it then becomes the primary responsibility of the dominated people, working collaboratively with every radical, heretical, maroon component within this newly constructed society to extract, map, and write a complete history, all while understanding that this history is not simply dates and or events, but is a living entity that evolves. It informs various forms of knowledge that guide lived experiences. The key to what I've just laid out is how and where do we begin? I, for one, argue, while we can surely begin anywhere, it is important to follow the African rhythms of resistance to being marginalized and or oppressed, because it is here at the nexus of what is and what ought to be we find a surge in the cultural production of a people. Seek out scribes, teachers, elders, cultural workers, activists, archives, institutions, mothers, fathers, aunts, etc., in order to stitch the fabric of historical and cultural memory back together. After all, one of Africa's most important freedom fighters, Amakal Gabral, once said that culture is simultaneously the fruit of a people's history as well as a determinant of history, by the positive and or negative influences which it exerts on the evolution of relationships between humanity and the environment, among men and women, as well as among different societies. I recently had the pleasure to sit down with one of the scribes, teachers, and cultural workers I highlighted a few moments ago, Brother Ah, to reflect upon Africa's deep influence on diasporic cultural production. Robert Northern, aka Brother Ah, is the musical director of the World Music Ensemble and the Sounds of Awareness Ensemble. He specializes in wind instruments, African drums, and percussions. Brother Ah constantly seeks to celebrate the emergence of a world culture while retaining the distinct expressions of each cultural style in it, paying particular attention to African inflections. Brother Ah's extensive experience spans the musical field. He is the musical director of Sounds of Awareness, a musical collective that utilizes music, dance, poetry, and the sounds of nature to inspire and raise individual levels of consciousness. The group also produces music for meditation, relaxation, and healing. He also founded the World Community School of Music in 1992 and offers musical and vocal music classes to students of all ages. As a lecturer and educator, he has taught at public and private schools in New York and Washington, D.C., as well as Brown University in Rhode Island for 9 years, Dartmouth College in New Hampshire for 3 years, Talladega College in Alabama. Brother Ah is a performer, educator, lecturer, composer, and arranger in both Western and non-Western traditions. He has composed and directed numerous extended works, including Ode to Creation, The Forces of Nature, and The Tribute to the Ancestors. Brother R, as a French hornist, has played and recorded with musical greats such as Thelonious Monk, John Coltrane, Miles Davis, McCoy Tyner, Freddie Hubbard, Sun Ra, Dizzy Gillespie, Eric Dolphy, Max Roach, John Lewis, to name a few. His classical performances include the New York Metropolitan Opera Stage Band, Radio City Music Hall Orchestra, symphony orchestras in Vienna, Austria, West Germany, and Broadway theater orchestras. He studied at the Manhattan School of Music in New York City, the Vienna State Academy in Vienna, Austria, and is a graduate of Howard University in Washington, D.C. And now, reflections on Africa's deep impact on diasporic cultural production with WPFW's own Brother Ah. Enjoy the program. Yes, I have the pleasure to be with Brother Ah today. I just wanted to thank you for taking time to out of your busy schedule to have a conversation with me about you and also the deep culture or the deep impact of cultural production
on us as humanity, but also specifically as us as being people of African descent, not only here in the United, I mean, in the United States, but all around the world. Mm-hmm. And your work is truly international. Mm-hmm. Your work is truly centered on a high level of humanity. Your work with your show, The Jazz Collectors, but also your work specifically in music. To kind of move this conversation, and I want to kind of start it at a very broad, but then kind of go at a specific. And I wanted to know, are there points in your life that you consider to be examples of or influences on your spiritual, intellectual, and musical evolution? And the reason why I'm asking you this is simply because Brother Ah is what you've known by, but you weren't always called Brother Ah. So could you give me some of the points in your life that you consider to be examples of or influences on your spiritual, intellectual, and musical evolution?
Yes, I can do that. And it might be surprising to realize that this, what you just described, started when I was 14 years old. It's not something that was an event in the 70s, in the 60s, or the... When I was a child, when I was a teenager, I had a revelation. And actually, what I wanted in life was to only play music in religious temples. I was very much influenced by the music around me when I was a teenager, which was bebop jazz. In my community, there was Living Thelonious Monk lived in my community, and Elmer Hope, and Bud Powell, and Fats Navarro, and so many wonderful jazz musicians. And I wanted to be a jazz trumpet player. However, during that period, I became very involved in religion. And I was searching for religion. I was baptized Catholic, and I renounced the Catholic Church at 14 years old because I, at that time, it was the Roman Catholic Church, and I'm from a 100% total black community in the South Bronx, going to St. Anthony's Church, which was with Europeans, with the Irish, and so forth, please. And I stopped going to church because they would not answer my questions about Christ being having African blood and Moses and the rest of them. So I renounced the church. And my father said, "Son, search." He told a priest, "My son is searching for truth." And he told me, "Son, you search." So I began to investigate many different religions, Islam. This is, of course, I'm talking about in the 1940s. This is before there was the black Muslims. There was just Islam and Buddhism and Confucianism. And I finally found a religion. My brother, older brother, was searching too. He guided me to a religion called Vedanta, which is one sect of Hinduism. And back in the day when I was just a teenager, I had a guru. And I went to the temple in New York City, three times a week, studied the Bhagavad Gita and Upanishad and so forth. And it was there that I decided that that's what I wanted to do. So right then, I was playing jazz, bebop, and at the same time, knowing that I wanted to have a spiritual reason to play that music, and I was going to be dedicating my life to playing in ashrams and temples around the world. That's when the seed was placed. And then, of course, I got involved in all kinds of musical activities. And when I went to many parts of the world, when it really came to a head again when I joined Sun Ra's band in 1964, which is when I truly began to realize what Sun Ra was teaching in terms of being not only international, but universal. Mm. And understanding the music of the universe and so forth. He enlarged my thinking. And that's when the transition began to really happen, when I joined Sun Ra's band in 1964.
Because you talk about the You said that it wasn't necessarily a socio-political or the socio-environment. It was more of a self-search and that revelation. And that's a very, very important, because even that revelation led you in your musical journeys to Sun Ra.
That's right.
Sun Ra, those who probably don't know, but those who probably should Google him if they don't know. But we know that Sun Ra had a very, very specific purpose. He's, you know, he was this searching. And one of the things that I'm finding specifically in your work, the idea of making this searching for a universal truth, but doing that through through music. What, there was an individual but collective thing going on here, right? There was a, you know, you were searching, but also it led you to a group, a collective. Tell me about, like, what was there one specific thing, or was it just in your movements? Because you were a musician, How did that searching kind of influence your music?
Well, it influenced my life, and music was part of my life, and it had a great influence on my music. Up until I was introduced to Sun Ra, which I didn't know anything about Sun Ra. I only knew his name. I mean, during those days in the early 60s, I was on the staff orchestra member of the Radio City Musical Orchestra in New York City, playing symphonic music. And in between shows, and we did 4 shows a day during the holidays, 5 shows a day. In between shows, my friends would come and hang out with me. And Eric Dolphy used to come, and we talked to discuss orchestration.
Eric Dolphy.
Used to come, and lots of different musicians. And one particular musician, his name was Patrick. He was a saxophonist, baritone saxophonist with Sun Ra. But we knew each other from our recordings we were doing with Odetta, one of the folk singers back in the day. And it was Pat Patrick kept saying, "Brother R, you must come and meet and listen to the music of Sun Ra." And I said, "Who is Sun Ra?" And he tried to describe it, but I said, "Well, I don't know what you're talking about." I said, "I'm too tired. After 4 shows a day, I like to go home." Finally, he insisted. One Monday night, I went with him down to a place called Slugs. It's a nightclub in the Lower East Side of Manhattan. For the first time I heard Sun Ra, it was such an impact on me that I literally was standing on the chairs and shouting, "Sun Ra!" I mean, I just went crazy. This music I heard, I've only heard this type of music in my mind. I've imagined this kind of music. I've heard these kind of sounds only in my mind. I've never heard Sun Ra before. Somehow it was so familiar. I just knew right then and there, this is the music I'm supposed to be playing. Because I when Sun Ra left the bandstand, he walked past me and I grabbed him by the wrist, literally, and said, I must play with this band. And he looked at John Gilmore and said, "Tell him to come, you know, to rehearsal." And actually, it was an audition. That's what he said. And I came to, and I went for the French Hornets. And at that time, I was playing, as I said, symphony work, Radio City Music Hall. I was playing at the Symphony Orchestra with Stokowski. And I had been playing with the Metropolitan Opera Orchestra. I was doing a lot of symphonic work. And I did do some jazz. I did some jazz with Thelonious Monk, you know, in 1959, and with Gil Evans, 1959. And I was playing with Train. But I never heard this kind of music before. I walked into rehearsal, and I went there on a rainy day, soaking wet. I walked into his small apartment on the Lower East Side, and he turned on the oven and told me to sit in front of the oven to dry off, and he said, left Marshall Allen, saxophonist, with me, and said, "Make sure he gets dry," and he left. And about half an hour later, he came back with a lot of different musicians and reams of music. And he set up the band, and he never had a French hornist in his group until that time, so he didn't have any French horn music. He was giving me trumpet parts, saxophone parts, any kind of part, and I played them all, as if I knew that was, and it was written kind of strange, with different intervals I never saw before, but however, I played it without a mistake.
Well, I wanted to pull on this thread here. You mentioned that you heard the music in your mind, and the music that you heard in your mind also was the music that Sun Ra was playing at the time,
yeah,
but is also matching the universal truth that you're trying to
exactly
match that a little bit more.
Yeah. Well, you know, the understanding of the music of nature is what prepared me. for this. I had spent, a lot of time in the woods, in the forest. I loved insects, I loved birds, and I loved the sound of the wind. I grew up as a little boy playing the bugle in the South Bronx, and I used to sit on my fire escape, like almost like my balcony, playing my bugle with a plunger, trying to imitate the sounds of the horses. You know, back in the day, I'm talking about back in the 30s, we still had a lot of horse and wagons, and they would come down my street, and I would try to imitate the men who were calling out, watermelons, and the dogs and the insects. So I was into this music. I was hearing natural music as almost like a symphony. I was being prepared for this because I've been hearing this music in my mind, but it was the music of nature that I was hearing, which to me was almost symphonic. And when I heard Sun Ra, it was all of these sounds that I had been, since a child, been absorbing and identifying with, but never ever heard an ensemble play like this, that immediately I knew this was something, this was a continuum of what I've been hearing in my mind, and it was Sun Ra.
This brings me to a very interesting question. I hope it's interesting, because what I'm hearing is that you're listening again, universal truth. You're trying to find something deeper. You're looking at the deep structure of culture. You're trying to understand your origins. You're trying to understand the evolution and the impact of these particular these components. Mm-hmm. Artist and musician. Is there a difference between an artist and a musician? Or should we be even concerned about that particular?
Well, I think there is a difference. There are musicians who are conscious, and the musicians who are unconscious of nature, of listening. For instance, what I'm trying to say, an artist can almost he can hear with his eyes, and he can see with his ears. And that's what was going on in Sun Ra's bed. I knew that these were artists because even with myself, I could see a painting, and I can hear the music as it comes out of that painting. As a matter of fact, I recorded a piece right now for painting up in my upstairs in my living room. I'll show you that painting. I looked at it and I heard the whole composition. I can hear music and see visions. That's what artists do. Musicians who are not level, they play beautiful music, but it's limited into what they are doing, and it's limited from what they understand from intellectual understanding and training, etc. But a true artist goes beyond the senses almost into a whole other realm where they can see and hear music everywhere. I was taught, to be able to look at the clouds, actually by a photographer, a real artistic photographer named Kufu Pata, which was one of my students at Brown University. We used to take walks and he would point out the geometry and the rhythms of clouds as the clouds related to the tops of trees and the rhythms. I mean, so I was hearing music everywhere. And when I got into the Sun Ra's bed, I couldn't believe it. So Sun Ra took me into the band and I was with them for 10 years.
Yeah, and I'm sure that was an experience, and it seemed like that particular opportunity was basically to be free within the context of being able to play what you heard and what you saw with your eyes.
Yes.
And your ears.
Yes.
and your emotion.
Yes.
And your feeling.
Yes.
And explain that experience being in Sun Ra's band.
Well, see, when I joined Sun Ra's band, I had already attended the Conservatory of Manhattan School of Music in New York. I also had attended the Vienna State Academy of Music in Vienna, Austria. Very well trained, educated musician, and knew all the laws of counterpoint and knew all the laws of harmony and structure. One day, I was with Sun Ra's, when I played with him, he would give you a solo and cut the band off. And one day, I was sitting next to him in Slugs, and he said, "Take a solo." This was my first performance. And I took a solo, and he cut the whole band off. And I was hearing all of these sounds that came to me from who knows where. In other words, that was the point where I realized that I was a conduit.
I am not afraid. Standing beneath the sun of the Creator, I am a reflection of that radiant light. I am not afraid. Drenched in the bath of eternal joy, I am the curve of the smile of the lightened brow. Moving to the pulse of vibrant rhythm, I am the primal beat of the unburdened heart.
Let's pick back up with the point that you were saying that you were Sun Ra shut the band off.
Oh, yes.
And you had to give a solo, and you felt that you were a conduit.
Yeah. That's when I realized, for the very first time, that something was coming through me. I'm a French horn player in a symphony orchestra, there's notation in front of you, there's a conductor, or I'm playing in a jazz band, and the chord changes, which you have to follow, and so forth. So I was... It was always, an intellect was a part of it. This time, it just flowed through me. I played so hard that I could not keep my mouthpiece, my horn on my lip, kept sliding. And then I looked down, I thought it was perspiration, it was blood. My lips were bleeding, and he only brought the band in when he realized that I realized that I was bleeding. I had gone so far into this other realm that I totally forgot. As a matter of fact, my fear was that I would drop my horn because I didn't feel that I had no sensation of holding my instrument anymore. It was like playing the air. And that took me, that baptism by blood, I don't know, that took me to a whole nother understanding about what comes through you as an artist and not what you conjecture. It just ran through me. So when I went to Sun Ra, and I was asking Sun Ra about the structure of the music, he said, listen, forget all the laws. The only that you've learned in school, forget those laws. The only laws that you have to know in my band is the laws of nature. He says, you study the laws of nature. And that took me into a whole other area of study. I began to study nature, living in nature. And it all really came to a greatest understanding when I was in Africa, living in a village, in the forest, in a mud hut, no running water, no electricity, just the stars and the moon at night, and living with nature. And also when I went to East Africa with the Maasai and literally being down in the Gorgor crater, literally with lions and elephants and hippopotamus and zebras, and cheetahs and birds, all down there with the Maasai, being totally engrossed in the sounds of nature.
So what would you do? You would sit there and just let the sound run through you, try to understand the patterns.
Well, what happened? First of all, when I went down into the crater, it's Ngorongoro crater, in Tanzania. It's a 110-mile inactive crater. I went down with the Maasai, and I asked the Maasai, number one, I said, "How do you all get these complicated rhythms?" I mean, he said, lay down. I said, what do you mean? He said, lay down on the ground and put your ear to the earth. And he put his 13-foot on my head to make sure. And he threw a stone at all these animals, and they all ran off. He says, that's not where we learn rhythm. You see all of these counter rhythms, all that? That's what you hear? You hear? Listen. And I'm hearing zebra, and I'm hearing all these, wildebeest, all these animals running, and I heard the rhythms of nature. They taught me how to listen to the birds and listen to these animals and listen to, the rhythms of zebras. Now, when I was they gave me a hut in the crater, totally dark. I mean, I couldn't even see my hands in front of my face, black at night. In the morning, I guess it was morning, I don't know, I heard all this barking around my hut, which I thought was wild dogs, man. I mean, I was scared that I was dead. But I finally had the nerve to peek out of my hut. There were zebras barking. So I sat and I listened to the rhythms of these zebras. See, I absorbed all of this. And if you hear my music, my composition, you will hear all of this that I'm talking about. I absorbed all of these laws of nature, sun, ra, set. So knowing that I can tap into that sound while I was with sun, ra, I mean, you know, all that came to, all that was coming together when I was living in the forest. And I began to hear all of nature. Now, I was listening to nature before I went to Africa, but it was, you know, nature that it was in New York and in the Bronx and in the forest. But when I heard those sounds of nature in the forest in Africa, it took me to a whole other understanding of music. Because then I said to myself, if there were no musicians on this earth, no musicians, no human beings, there would still be music. Planet Earth has music. And this is the music that I was tapping into, without, not made by man. And the musicians who were consciously or unconsciously involved in nature, involved in the sounds of nature, create this kind of music. You know, it just comes out of them without, as I said, they were conduit. It just comes through them because they're in tune with this, with the environment. And I spend time very early in the morning. I sometimes go in a park in Washington, D.C. called Rock Creek Park. Or sometimes late at night, I can hear the tone. There's a certain key tone that's in this city every day. And sometimes it's the same tone, sometimes it changes. And I used to listen to this tone, and sometimes if I couldn't identify, I would call home my daughter, and I'd say, Dar, go to the piano. And I'd hum the tone that I'm hearing in the dip up to the park. And I said, find this note on the piano. I would sing it, and she would find, there's an E-flat going through the environment today. And everything I composed that day was in the key of the day.
I was just about to ask you, how deep is Africa in the music?
Step in there, man.
It's deep.
It's deep. Oh. And it's deep in a lot of jazz musicians who've gone to Africa. Mm-hmm. Sonny Rollins, I'm going to name a bunch of cats, that Louis Armstrong, all these cats, man. Maxwell.
These artists, because, I mean, we have a long list of artists. Your music, of course, stands as its own. Among people that that we know. We know that you've played with a number of these artists, but one of the things that I'm finding is specifically, the artists that were not appreciated then, but that are appreciated now, had this searching, sort of like yourself. Like, they had this searching, like most people, and it seemed like Africa was always a place that was drawn. Mm-hmm. So a person that is seeking these rhythms, such as yourself, and of course, I'm looking at this as a collective process. You talked about Sonny Rollins. You talked about, you mentioned Eric Dolphy. There's a number of artists that were around you that kind of had a collective process of searching for something more, and Africa seemed to have drawn them. Could you talk about that a little bit more? Was Africa drawn? I mean, the continental geographical landmass, the culture, was it the culture, the people? What was it that that you were looking?
Well, it's all of that, but it's on a spiritual level as well. And I'd say, what I'm trying to say is that we were torn from Africa. You don't have to be born in Africa to be an African. Africa's born in you. Africa was born in us. It has not left us at all. Believe me, we still have an unconscious cosmic memory, which is disguised with all of the cultures that we're exposed to in the West. When you go home, it's like. Well, let me explain the way it happened to me. When I first went to Africa for the first time in 1972. When I stepped off of that plane, I fell on my face. I mean, I didn't expect this would happen. I was almost pulled down on my knees and flat face, and I wept so hard that I almost went unconscious. And the only one that pulled me out of it, that the bag handlers in the airport were also drummers. They all grabbed their drums, and they surrounded me, and they played for me to come up. I was home. I mean, you've been to Africa?
Yes.
Well, you know the feeling.
Yeah.
I was home. I mean, all these 300 years, all that stuff just kind of, I mean, it was so comfortable. I'm home. And I did not spend one day in the city. I went up to Kumasi, Ghana, and I went into the forests, and I stayed in the forest. And it's like I never left. I, like 300 years, disappeared, and I was an African. And I've related to my environment again. You know, all of the things that we've been torn away from came back to me, to my cosmic memory. And all of a sudden, as I said, I felt very much a part of the environment, as if I'd never left. And I went back every year, 7 consecutive summers. I was teaching, well, at that time, when I was teaching at Dartmouth College. And every year, well, I was at Dartmouth, and I was taught at Brown University, for 7 consecutive years, when that last class was over in June, I was on the plane to Africa. You know, and I would walk into the forest. They would say to me, "How do you find us? Even the villagers from the next village can't find us. You just walk in there." I said, "Yeah, well, I mean, just winding path through the forest, man. I'd come and play my flute." And they say, "Brother, ah, I see." They couldn't believe it that I found a village again. I'm so much a part of that. But what happens? I wear it on the inside. It's not so apparent. I mean, I'm just another cat out here. But what goes on the inside of me, what I hear and what I think and what I do is from a whole understanding of my roots. So my music is based in root music. It's the root. It's in rhythmically, harmonically, it's the nature, it's birds. It's not my music is not put together from the traditional European theoretical way that I learned in school. I mean, that's what I did. It comes from a whole nother sensibility now. You know, and I trust what I hear, and I put down what I hear.
I'm thinking, and actually, this is actually a good segue into the question that I was going to ask you specifically. The conceptualization of the concept of jazz. There's conversation. There's always been conversation of what is jazz, what isn't jazz, and of course we know that there's a number of Sun Ra. Kind of defied those particular conceptualizations. We know Ornette Coleman defied those particular conceptualizations. Sonny Rollins. There's a number of individuals. Yourself. What is your take on this concept of jazz? This concept of that. And you talked about the European the European setup. Of jazz. We know that Ornette Coleman in the free, you know, releasing that free jazz album kind of was like very direct and saying, you know, we're moving away from that. But you were already doing this. You were already doing this work specifically at the age of 14. The only thing it seems like your experiences just gave you different verbiage to kind of explain what you were doing. But What is your take on the concept of jazz?
Well, thank you for the question. We have to understand our history. We have to understand, and you can only get the true feel of what I'm saying if you have been to Cape Coast Africa, if you've gone down in those dungeons where they had our people, and where they began the Middle Passage. If you have that feeling of understanding, then you know that what we took with us is the culture and music that was within us. We were chained in the bottom of the ships. We had no musical instruments, but the music was in our head, in our minds. When the Africans that were taken to the Caribbean, you know, they were able to develop an African music there in the West Indies. Of course, it came out differently than here. It came out to reggae and, you know, and calypso and the rhythms that they were developing African music, changing African music. It was African music, but as it manifested itself in the Caribbean. When the Africans came to North America, coming down the Mississippi and into New Orleans, they also put on African music. But the African music that was developed in North America took on another kind of music development. It was still African music. They called it jazz, but it was African music, and they could only play it in Congo Square. And it was a manifest. The rhythms that the New Orleans musicians played. I mean, if you took the music of King Oliver, if you took the music of Louis Armstrong, those musicians, and if you played it rhythmically, and musicians can do this. I can hear a solo by Louis Armstrong, and I can play it rhythmically without the melody, exactly what he played. Those are African rhythms. I mean, so the way African music developed in North America is what we call jazz, but it's really an African music. Unfortunately, gave the music the name jazz. It was spelled originally, I guess you might know, J-A-S-S, jazz. It's a Creole word that they developed for the type of music played in the houses of prostitution. However, it's an African music, and that's the way it manifests. When the same Africans went down to Brazil and to Cuba, it developed to another type of African music. But this is all African music. It just took on a different manifestation depending upon where it was developed. It was all African music.
I'm listening, and I'm hearing this when the rhythms of the environment. And it's interesting how this conversation is actually linking when you're saying you went to Rock Creek Park and you was listening to the rhythm, and you heard a rhythm of the day. Mm-hmm. And I'm seeing that historical genealogy, that spiritual genealogy that is also within the context of people experiencing hardships, joy, love, oppression, marginalization. Everything is happening at once, and then there's a rhythm that comes out of that.
Right.
Interesting that you said that you was walking, when you would go to Africa, you'd be walking in the woods and you was playing your flute. We know one your instruments are the flute and the French horn and the drum.
Percussion. Yeah. I play everything you see in my studio. Basically I'm a wind player. I started as a wind player as a little boy, 5 years old. And I developed my flute interest, really, I guess, from Don Cherry, who was also a wind player, a trumpet player. I used to do work with Don Cherry in different groups, Charlie Hayden's group, Liberation Orchestra, other groups. And I remember one night, very late at night, we walked through Central Park, and he pulled out two bamboo flutes at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, and the sounds were bouncing off of the buildings on Central Park West, and I got very interested in the flute. So he taught me how to play two bamboo flutes at one time. So my interest in flute really began, I always loved the sound, but it really began when bamboo flutes with Don Cherry. And then when I was with Sunrise Band, Marshall Allen just influenced me a lot, and I got a Western flute after hearing Marshall Allen. And Marshall Allen actually taught me how to hold and play the Western flute. So I got into flute. So I'm a French brass player. Started out as a bugle, jazz trumpet player. Went to French horn. And that was really something that I didn't choose. It chose me. You know, I was in high school. I went to the High School of Performing Arts. And they recognized that that there was a rule that one could not play for one's own graduation. And they found out close to graduation that the one French hornist in the orchestra was graduating, so he could not perform. And they were doing a Dvorak New World Symphony. And so they asked all the brass players to learn this symphony, which I did. And I learned the French horn and got a scholarship based upon my performance at graduating to the Manhattan School of Music. So I ended up on a full scholarship as a French hornist, and I went to Vienna. So I became a French horn player. And I play wind instruments, brass and flutes and percussion.
Can you talk about the continuities? You talked about Don Cherry and the continuities amongst you and your colleagues, as you was evolving, as you were searching, as you were going to Africa, as you were going to, as you were teaching at Dartmouth and you were teaching at
Brown.
What was the exchange of ideas between you and your contemporaries like?
Well, you know, there was a, I guess you would I almost used the word clique, but there was a group of musicians in the 60s who were revolutionaries all together. Politically and culturally, they were finding out that there's a certain commonality that we all have, which is Africa. So you had my friends in college, like Max Roach, whom I went to school with, and Mingus, and all these cats. I can name a lot of musicians, Archie Shepp, and Pharoah Sanders. I mean, all of us began to go in another direction, finding out that we are not limited anymore to the Western concept of music. So I was very much in tune with the group of musicians who were going that way. I was very much encouraged by Max Roach to release my music, which was quite different than jazz. As a matter of fact, when Downbeat magazine got a hold of my first recording, they gave me 1 star. They didn't realize, well, you couldn't call it jazz, it wasn't jazz.
Yeah.
You know, and we were all getting away from that. Duke Ellington would refuse to call his music jazz.
And the models were wrong. The models were trying to judge your music
Well, they were the wrong models. Mm-hmm. And but like I said, even Duke Ellington refused that word jazz. You know, so there was a group of musicians in San Robins at the forefront of that movement, really avant-garde, they called it back then. So I had colleagues. I was really very much into this group of musicians who were moving away from so-called jazz and moving back, which they didn't identify yet, moving back to an African concept of music, without calling it African music. But however, they were. Max Roach was going to Ghana. Living with Guy Wan, this is Western then, Kofi Ghanaba, mm-hmm. You know, Max Roach was in the fall. I mean, other musicians were going back home and they were integrating, Milford Graves, all these cast men were integrating the concepts that we knew existed when we were consciously aware of the continuum of African music. So I was very much a part of that group and very much influenced. We were influencing each other. You know, I went to London, I took Melford Graves to London with me and Laraji, and we went into London playing this type of music. Melford Graves would come out on the stage and he would play with his drums on the stage floor. And he would make sounds like as if he were a gorilla. All over the stage, and I would come out and I would play conch shells and stuff. And then we'd go into what's called jazz, you know. So I was very much into that group of musicians who were moving forward and backward at the same time. Backward to the African traditional culture and moving it forward to what they call avant-garde by not being limited by Western concepts and theory.
So it was basically almost like a resistance, but also sociopolitically, this was around
in the 60s.
So would you say that there was like a conscious or a subconscious connection between the political
It wasn't subconscious, it was conscious.
It was conscious.
It wasn't subconscious. I remember Dizzy Gillespie gave this call and said he was going to picket Lincoln Center. I said, what? He said, yes. So he says, because Lincoln Center only played European classical music. And Lincoln Center, as he said, was paid for and supported by all taxpayers in New York. So we were out walking out politically out in front of Lincoln Center with signs, you know, very politically motivated, and letting people know that this is racism, this is discrimination. How can you discriminate against black music? You know, so great. This girl Leslie was invited to play the very first jazz concert at Lincoln Center, and Diz invited me to join the band. So I was very much a part of his political thinking and playing at Lincoln Center. And then I remember I was playing in Carnegie Hall with Gil Evans, and we were playing with Miles Davis and John Coltrane, that band, that wonderful band. That was with Gil Evans. And out on the stage, we took an intermission. Max Roach, my friend and mentor, came over and just, man, he had all these signs. We're gonna stop this concert, man, politically, because the people who are sponsoring this concert are really sponsoring apartheid in South Africa, you know, with some big corporation. I said, well, man, Max, I can't hold a sign and play, man, and I got to play. So he said, he excused me. But in the middle of this concert, Max Roach walked out cross-legged and held these signs up in the middle of this and stopped the concert, man. And then the stage had physically picked him up and put him out on 57th Street out on the street. So, and I called him afterwards and said, Max, he said, don't worry about it, man, I understand. But politically, as musicians, got to become more politically involved. So I was on many picket lines. I was in many demonstrations with all of us. I mean, Lee Morgan, you know, he walked into the recording, the television stations and TV and stopped the doggone TV shows. Lee Morgan, man, because he was also politically involved. There were lots of musicians who were politically involved in the 60s.
How did that influence your music? How did that push you? Did that have any type of influence on pushing you to push the music?
Yes. And what it did was remind me of the days when bebop just came about. And that was political. And that was pushing the music. And the way they did it, and they consciously did spoke about it. You know, they wanted to create a music that white people couldn't play. Because white people were exploiting our music. The swing band, they were calling Benny Goodman the King of Swing, and they record, and they were making more money than the band. So the musicians got together and consciously said, man, we're going to play that music. They can't play it. Mm-hmm. So, and it was manifested, one of the ways it was manifested in the tempo of the music. There was a certain feeling of urgency that we should move forward as the people. Urgency in the tempos of the music. That influenced me. And it influenced a lot of us. So a lot of my music, you know, I even wrote a march called Transcendental March. That was the music of the struggle, that's called it. Transcendental March because it was about transcendental meditation. Go into your inner self and change yourself. And the only way that you can change the world is that you change yourself. So I created this song, which is recorded, called Transcendental March. I use that mantra, boom. I mean, you know, and a lot of us were doing march rhythm. Blakey came up with a march rhythm. We were all doing marches and stuff, trying to instill upon the listener the sense of urgency, political urgency, change.
And it's change, and I'm seeing a connection. Again, there's a collective process here. There's a collective of you understanding you, yourself as an artist. And also your role and responsibility as an artist within the context of everything that's going on. And there seems to be a conversation that is going on consistently between you guys, but also what you were doing with the music.
Yes.
Resisting a commodification, so to speak, of the music, and also of the music, but also the culture, the deep-rooted aspect of the culture, almost like a form of resistance to slavery, so to speak, right? I wanted to kind of bring this conversation to looking at today. We have Black Lives Matter. Are you familiar with Fees Must Fall in South Africa? There's student protests going on. There's a decolonization movement going on around the world about students trying to kind of break these European curriculums and education systems. And it seems like it's just a repeat of what was going on in a different context. What is your view? What do you see, just in your observation, from your vantage point, which is a very, very, very expansive vantage point, about Black Lives Matter and things that are going on, not only here in the United States, but also in Brazil and other places. There are people kind of formulating the resistance. And of course, there's a hip hop strand underneath this as well. What are some of your ideas? Or some of your responses to some of the resistance that is going on by the youth today, because you guys are young doing this. Mm-hmm. There seems to be, again, a cyclical pattern of resistance. Yeah. And also the form of music that they're being used now, they're calling it hip hop, but it's the same thing of what free jazz or the avant-garde were doing as well. Do you see any of those connections, or what are some of from your vantage point, what are some of your observations?
Well, I'm very, very supportive of the young musicians who are involved in this music that's called hip hop. I became very interested in, number one, because it really began in the South Bronx What?
Where are you from?
I was raised in the South Bronx, and the revolutionary music called bebop was also being developed in the South Bronx. So I've been a part of that understanding of the South Bronx and its connection with politics and culture since I was a youngster. And it's good. And when they came out with the graffiti and all those great things out of the South Bronx, that struggle has never ended. It has been a continuum. And what's going on now, it's a continuum. And I mean, not only of the 40s, it's a continuum of the struggle that we've had when we first were stolen from Africa. It hasn't ended. And the young people around the world are finally understanding that we are the majority on the planet, always have been the majority on this planet. And we've been controlled through so-called education, but the lack of education, or
the miseducation, as Carter G. Woodson would say, right?
The miseducation, yes, right. And we have been brainwashed to the point that we truly have forgotten our cosmic memory of who we are and who controls, and who were the first on this planet. I mean, it's becoming apparent to the youngsters now that, listen, we now can bust loose of all of this. We don't need to have these rules and laws and so forth. We were here first, and they're beginning to understand it, and they're trying to shut down finally the control that has been placed upon us by the colonialists and about what's going on through different governments, and trying to control it and trying to stamp out our natural resource and our natural way of looking at the planet, the world. So it's very significant what's going on around the world. I'm very supportive of what's happening.
Your music, I wanted to kind of, what rhythms do you hear today? Have you had a chance to listen to some of the rhythms? What are some of the rhythms that you hear today?
Yeah, well, I tell you, I've been giving a lot of listening to the voices of our people. I'm really hearing the rhythms of our language. It's become so much a part of my music now. For those of us who don't only speak standard English, unfortunately, respect of the black dialect has caused us many times to not speak our rhythms, and to speak rhythmically. So although most of us black people, we don't think in standard English. We don't think in standard English. We have two ways of speaking. You know, I speak at home and amongst my friends in a certain way. When I'm teaching or when I'm in another area, I use standard English. However, I don't think in standard English. You know, in my home, I don't speak standard English. My daughter says, "Daddy, how you feeling?" I don't say, "I'm feeling very well, daughter." I don't say that. I say, "I'm cool. You know, I feel good. How you doing?" You know, I mean, that's the way we speak in my house, you know. So, how you doing? I can play all these rhythms of our peoples through the language. So I'm very, 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 very sensitive now, particularly to the language of our children. As it spontaneously comes out, before they're educated to the fact that you must speak standard English, blah, 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 and because they wipe out the rhythms of our music, so we sound like, that we're from another culture. I'm listening to the rhythms of our people's voices, and that's really been part of what I've been doing, is to interpret these the language on my musical instruments.
So the sound awareness, you talk a lot about sound awareness. Is this the encapsulating what we're talking about
yeah.
here?
Mm-hmm.
Could you talk a little bit more? I mean, so sound awareness, you're listening to the rhythms of nature, but right now
rhythms.
You're listening to the rhythms of
our voices.
Of voices. And it's interesting that you said the way that we speak, you know, that particular strain of thought also kind of guides the way to our behaviors.
Mm-hmm.
So if we're speaking in a language that's foreign, or a language that is keeping us in a certain specific place and not being able to allow to free ourselves.
Okay.
What are the impacts of that within the context of like sound awareness?
Well, as I said earlier, if there were no musicians on the earth, we would have the sounds around us of nature. Sound awareness began, it's my musical philosophy. It's the name of my ensemble. And it began again of my cosmic awareness of the sounds around me as a little boy in the South Bronx. And as I said earlier, I imitated all of these sounds and the language of these sounds with my bugle and a plunger. I'm doing like this, sitting. So I was into this as a youth. When I came back from Europe, from studying, I came back from Europe in 1958. I was offered a position to teach in the South Bronx in my community. And one day I walked into my classroom and I taught brass instruments. I taught trumpet, trombone, baritone, horn, tuba, and it was all of this, I called it noise. And I walked in and I said, "Students, sit down. What are you all doing?" They said, "Mr. Northern, you please sit down and listen." And being I always respect the young people, always respect the students, I didn't say what the average teacher would have said, but don't you tell me, you shut up and sit down. I sat down. They opened up the windows and they told me to listen. And they were playing all the different sounds that were floating in through the window. Sirens, everything. Which I did when I was a boy, and I had forgotten. So they said to me, "Mr. Northern, aren't you aware of sound?" Sound awareness. I said, "What? Aren't you aware of sound? That's what we're hearing." I said, "Yes, I'm so sorry. I forgot." That's the way I was raised as a musician, listening to the sounds. So I've been listening to the sounds of these environmental sounds, which include language, to the point that when I have students, even at Dartmouth, I would take them in the woods and I would have them listen. When I taught little children here, I would take them on Florida Avenue. I would walk them, the whole class, along during the shore and shore, and I would tell them to listen to every sound that you hear, and then when you go back to the classroom, I want you to write down what you heard. Unbelievable what these kids heard. Amongst the din of the traffic on U Street, they heard all the birds, they heard all the rhythms, everything they heard. I was amazed. And they would write them all down and try to imitate them. So this idea of the voices was so critical to me that when I was teaching at Brown University, I would come on the weekends to Harlem, when I moved from the South, I'm born in North Carolina, we lived in Harlem, I would go on 125th Street as a research project. I would put a microphone, I would hide my microphone in my coat, I would walk behind people on 125th Street who were having conversations, just ordinary conversations, a lot of it was profanity. I would recall everything. I'd bring that back to my classroom at Brown University's, put it on a loudspeaker and say, "Listen to these rhythms." And I said, "Okay, let's play that." And man, we would play the rhythms that they heard. I made them very sensitive and understanding what the rhythms that we create as voice, because that's very, very much part of our communication, is the rhythms that we create. When we talk, when we speak, those rhythms can be transferred to musical instruments.
The voices of God.
Yeah, there you go. Coming through us.
And it's very interesting that you said that the children would hear through these sounds, because I'm often say that children, we kind of mess up children, adults. I often consider children to be the closest thing to the Creator.
That's right.
And it's us that kind of mess them up and kind of make them not remember. And it's interesting this journey that you became aware of since you was 14, of being connected to the universe, and how you were reconnected back when the children said, "Are you aware of sound?"
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. And thank goodness that I can remember these things at my age. I mean, I'm 82 years old now, and I'm still remembering stuff when I was 14. I mean, I'm just so blessed that my memory is intact. I can say all of these things. I have friends now, unfortunately, that could remember back in the 1948. I can remember vividly 1948, 1947, 1938. I can remember.
Wow. You have a long list of people that have worked with you, and you have worked with Sun Ra. You mentioned Sun Ra, Rasan, Roland Kirk, Charlie Hayden. Thelonious Monk, McCoy Tyner, Andrew Hill, Jack McDuff, Quincy Jones, Dizzy Gillespie, Milt Jackson, Freddie Herbert. That's a rhythm, right?
I'm listening to you. I can play what you do.
Donald Byrd, Gary McFarlane, Miles Davis, Eric Dolphy, Don Cherry, Coltrane, John Lewis. And you mentioned Don Cherry. I was actually listening to John Cherry when I was Chinzrick, I think it's Brentwood Brown Rice. And Chinzrick was an album that he was actually, was a song that was a rhythm. It just basically was a hum, a meditation. And, you know, finding those particular places, we often talk about finding our peaceful places. Finding those places through rhythm in the midst of chaos becomes very important. It seems to be a human trait. How we'll end with this particular, because I we probably could be here all day. I got like 1,000 questions just in this particular conversation. How do you think, or have you, what is the influence of freeing the music? Can you see any other strands that in any other music genres that can use some freeing, so to speak?
You mean within black music?
Within black music, yeah.
Well, I mean, you know, bebop is still being performed, and it still has the formula in the format of a constructed chordal chord changes. The form is there. I think that we need to, I mean, I say we, the young people who are still continuing bebop, and I'm glad to have to really understand that bebop was the beginning of something, and we should be going past it now. And thank goodness Miles understood it. Miles Davis pushed the envelope. Miles went beyond it. And was encouraging other people to go beyond it. Of course, he just because of his ill health, you know, he had, he died of sickle cell anemia and diabetes and so forth. But he pushed it, and began to push it. And there are many wonderful musicians today who are still playing bebop in the way it was formed and structured in the 40s, mainly because bebop has now been accepted into educational institutions. Bebop did not begin in educational institutions. It began with community musicians in the street. And it was definitely a community-based music, developed out of the language and the words that were being used in our community. We call it slang back then. You know, oopapada, ulyaku. You know, I mean, those are words that we used to say, you know, back in the day. You know, bam! You know, we use a whole other kind of vocabulary, and I have a dictionary upstairs of the language that the bebop was using. It was created out of the language. What happened? You know, all those things that we used to do, you know, that Cab Calloway and Dizzy, all these cats were creating this whole language that came directly out of the community. When it got into schools, it changed. I went to the Manhattan School of Music in the early 50s. It's a conservative music in Manhattan. You were not allowed to play jazz in any of the music schools. I went in the same school. Max Roach was there playing timpani in the orchestra. Joe Wilder was playing, and Donald Byrd was playing Bach. Nobody could play jazz. But what these great jazz musicians were there. John Lewis was there. Max Roach was in the same school. Donald Byrd was in there. Eddie Byrd, Julius Watkins. I can go on and on. All these great jazz musicians, and not one note of jazz could be played. So we're all playing classical music. You see. So when they finally got the understanding that white youngsters wanted to learn to play jazz, they started putting in all these music schools now jazz and creating music schools that you learn jazz in a music school. We never learned jazz that way. There were no schools, you know, that you learn jazz. You learn jazz in the community from other musicians and listening to your people language and being a part of it. It's definitely a community-based music. Now it's a music that one learns in school. So they're creating the same type of bebop forms of this in schools now that we shouldn't be doing that anymore. We ain't learning that way. Mm-hmm. None of us learn jazz in the school. We learned it in the street, listening and helping one another and doing it and playing records. But unfortunately, they've locked it into educational processes now. So you go to, the Berklee School of Music or even the Manhattan School of Music now, even Juilliard, which has a jazz, and you're learning jazz the same way. Yeah. So I tell my friends who are youngsters, learn it from learn it the way we learn it, by ear. And they see the true traditions which exists in the world. There's a form, the form that the Europeans have the written notated music, and then there's the older tradition, which is really the tradition of three quarters of the planet, which is the oral tradition. You learn by ear. That's Africa. You don't go in the middle of the forest with a fantastic musician. Let me tell you, virtuoso musician. They don't read any music. You go to Japan, then you go to India. You know, you go to with the Aborigines in Australia, you go to Cuba, anybody with no music, you learn it by ear. That's called the oral tradition. The Europeans did not accept the oral tradition as a tradition, and they said if you cannot read and write music in the Western tradition, you're not legitimate. That's what they told me. You got to be a legitimate musician, you have to read and write Western notated music. So we all learn to preach, but that's not the way jazz was created. It was created in New Orleans when all these tribes came together. In New Orleans, you can only play the music of our people on Sunday at Congo Square. And there were Africans from all different parts of Africa, all coming together, playing together, jamming together. That created a music that eventually became jazz. It was an input of all of these different languages from all of these different cultures. You had Africans in Congo Square from Senegal, from West Africa, East Africa, all around. Out of this music came a whole other language. It was a synthesis of all the different languages that were being spoken in Congo Square. But it came from the people, not learned in an educational institution. So when I taught at Dartmouth, for 3.5 years, I taught at Brown University for 9 years. I taught at Talladega College in Alabama. I taught at UDC, all over the place. I legitimatized the old tradition, but I had to deal with the provost, deal with the chairman of the department. I had to deal with all of that. This is a tradition. I said, I can do the notation. I was educated in Vienna. I was the first African-American in the Metropolitan Opera Orchestra and stage band. I've played with the Radio City Music. I played symphonies in Vienna and in Germany. I had my own job in Germany, a French one in Wiesbaden, Germany. I know that tradition. I mean, I'm up. But man, that's not our tradition. So when I taught at this institution, I taught strictly from the oral tradition. You know, and there was problems I had with chairmen and this, that, and the other, but I legitimatized it. I mean, at Brown University, at every semester, the provost would insist that I qualify what I do in terms, in front of the chairman of the English department. All these professors would be here. They have to come in, they would question me, and I would have to legitimize my oral tradition. I had to do that. So finally, I walked in there with all kind of books and stuff, and theory books and all that, and I knew all of that stuff, and I went beyond it. And at the end of that presentation, I asked, are there any questions? Not one professor had a question. That was it. They never invited me again to do that. I was there 9 years. But they took me to the chamber because I had to qualify. I said, all traditions, it's the tradition of most of the world. It's only Europe and white America that creates conservative music based upon this notated tradition. We don't need that. But see, because the bebop sounds the same now. And I love bebop. Believe me, I really do. I love the music. I love it. But that's just one part of our vast, music called black music, and the swing, there's bebop, there's ragtime, there's gospel, there's hip hop, You know, there's rhythm and blues. All that's our music, but it all its rootest is the all tradition.
Well, and the reason why this is important, we will end on this point. And the reason why this is a very, very important conversation because these forms inform each other. And so if you're prioritizing one particular form, a dominant form, claiming it's a dominant form, but it's not claimed as a dominant form from the people who actually play the music or actually has the oral tradition or actually has that genealogy, the historiography, then what you're doing is that you're arresting the development of the music, of the sound, and also the other things that come along with it, the knowledge that is developed from that. And I'm hearing you, and I'm also thinking about hip hop. I mean, I'm one of the things that I try to do is I try to look at the influences of, I'm specifically looking at avant-garde, what it's called avant-garde, and how it influenced hip-hop. And I often say that hip-hop needs a free jazz moment as well. And I'm hearing what you're saying is being born from a specific place, a culture. Mm-hmm. It was more than just music,
right.
is what you're saying.
Right.
You know. So I wanted to thank you for taking the time to talk with me today. And hope to have another opportunity to talk with you soon.
Yes, no problem.